Right. As the next example, take the function f of x equals the natural log of x over x squared. In terms of the domain, what issues do we have to worry about? Well, when it comes to the natural log of x, the input number x has to be greater than 0. And in the denominator, we can't have x squared equaling 0, which would imply that x equals 0. But as the natural log already thinks that x should be greater than 0, we get that our domain is going to be 0 to infinity. Right there. I'm going to circle it so we see that. If we switch our attention to x-intercepts and y-intercepts, I should say, the y-intercept doesn't exist because, after all, if x can equal 0, that's exactly where the y-intercept is. So there's no y-intercept. If we think of it in terms of the x-intercepts, when does the natural log of x over x squared equal 0? Timesing both sides by x squared, you get that when does the natural log of x equal 0? And using the inverse function relationship here, the natural log of x equals 0 implies x equals e to the 0, aka 1. And so this gives us our x-intercept. We have a single x-intercept right there at 1. In terms of discontinuities, the only discontinuity we'd have to worry about would be when x goes to 0, because that makes the denominator go 0, but that's already outside the domain. So I guess there's an issue about what happens as we approach 0. That basically leads us automatically to the end behavior, right? What happens as x approaches, say, 0 from the right, the natural log of x over x squared? And so if we investigate this, what's the natural log of 0 from the right over 0 plus squared? Well, the denominator is pretty simple. If you square a positive, it stays positive. So we're going to be just a little bit to the right of 0, 0 plus here. The natural log, as zero, x approaches 0 from the right, the natural log wants to go towards negative infinity. And so we might be worried, is this an indeterminate form? Well, if you divide by 0, that's kind of like the same thing as multiplying by infinity. So this really looks like negative infinity times positive infinity. And that's actually not an indeterminate form whatsoever. That would just be negative infinity. And so this will represent a vertical asymptote on the graph. That is, as you get closer and closer to 0, you're going to be approaching negative infinity. We also should see what it does on the right-hand side. Take the limit as x approaches infinity, the natural log of x over x squared. Now, in this situation, if you just plug in x equals infinity here, you're going to get the natural log of infinity over infinity squared. This one actually does have an indeterminate form, infinity over infinity. So to resolve this one, I would recommend using L'Hopital's rule, for which we can take the derivative of top, which would give 1 over x, and the derivative of the bottom, which is 2x, as x approaches infinity still. Simplifying that fraction, we're going to end up with 1 over 2x squared as x goes towards infinity. And in that situation, we're going to end up with 1 over infinity, which is 0. So this function has a horizontal asymptote at the x-axis. All right, the remainder of what we need to talk about comes from the derivatives. So let's compute the derivatives of these things. I still feel pretty awful what I did earlier, just skipping through the derivative. We should do the calculation. All right, we can do it. Those steps I did skip before, you can find them in the lecture notes. But let's do the quotient rule this time. So we get low d high minus high d low. Square the bottom, here we go. And so factor the top, we'll simplify things first, I guess. X squared times 1 over x is just an x. We get minus 2x times the natural log of x over x to the fourth. You can factor out the x that's in the top, and that leaves behind 1 minus 2 natural log of x over x to the fourth, for which we can cancel the x on top with one of the x's on the bottom. And so we get 1 minus 2 natural log of x over x cubed. We want to remember this guy right here because we're going to have to take the second derivative in just a moment. But in the meanwhile, let's think of the critical numbers. The denominator goes to 0 when x is 0. We already know that's the boundary of the domain. When does the numerator go to 0? 1 minus 2 natural log of x. We solve this equation right here. We can add 2 times the natural log of x to both sides. So we get 1 equals 2 ln of x, which would tell us the natural log of x equals 1/2, or x equals e to the 1/2 power, or if you prefer, the square root of e. And let's see, the square root of e, that's approximately, I should have put this in my calculator beforehand. This is approximately 1.65 for future reference. Let's compute the second derivative. If we take the derivative of the function we had before, again, we can use the quotient rule to help us along the way. So we get low d high, the derivative of 1 minus 2 natural log of x would be negative 2 over x minus high d low, square the bottom, here we go. So we get x to the 6th in the bottom right here. And then trying to simplify this thing along the way, x cubed times negative 2x will give us negative 2x squared. We get this negative 3x squared times 1 minus 2 natural log of x all over x to the 6th. So factor out the negative x squared that's common to the numerator. Whoops, sorry about that. And then that leaves behind, what do we got? A 2 plus 3 times 1 minus 2 natural log of x. And this sits above the denominator, which is x to the 6th. So we can simplify the denominator a little bit. We get x squared canceled there, leaving 4 there. What's going to happen in the numerator? We're going to have 3 times 1, which is 3, plus 2, which is a 5. So we get negative 5. And then we're going to get a negative 6 natural log of x sitting above x to the 4th. So the PPIs here, again, the denominator will go to 0 at 0. The numerator will go to 0. Well, in that situation, you get 5 minus 6 natural log of x equals 0. Very similar to what we did a moment ago. We're going to get the natural log of x is equal to 5/6. And so our PPI, I should say potential point of inflection, we don't know it's an inflection point yet, it's going to be e to the 5/6 power. Which is approximately 2.3. So let's try to graph those points right here. Now, our critical number was 1.65, the square root of e. So we get this point, well, we had an x-intercept. Let's do that one first. The x-intercept was at 1. The critical number is going to be 1.65 approximately. If you plug it into the function, you're going to get something super, super teeny tiny. If you put that into the function, you get a 0.18. So in terms of scale, let's actually make the y coordinate be 0.1, 1/10 right there. And so when you look at the y coordinate, this thing is just going to be a teeny little guy right here. So we get this 0.1.65, comma, what did I say, 0.18, super small. And then for our point of inflection, we got e to the 5/6, which was about 2.3. If you plug that into the original function f, you're going to get 0.16 of the y-coordinate. So what did I say, 2.3. So we graph that, it's going to be about right here, 2.23. 2.3, excuse me, and then 0.16. That guy's not very big whatsoever. And so we know we have a vertical asymptote at the x-axis, at the y-axis. We have a horizontal asymptote at the y-axis. And if we fill out our sine chart here, so we're looking at 1.63, and 2.3. If we look at the second derivative, which is off the screen right now, come back up. Our second derivative was this thing right here. The denominator is always going to be positive. There's a negative in front. This thing will be negative until it hits its x. I'm sorry. This thing should be, yeah, this thing will be positive until it hits its x-intercept, and it'll switch to be negative. But because of the negative sign, it actually switches things around. So if we were to plug these into our function right here, into the second derivative, it's going to be negative, negative, and then positive. And so what this tells us is that we have a point of inflection. It's going to be concave downward, like this, going towards negative infinity. And then at this point, it's going to switch to be concave upward as it approaches the horizontal asymptote, which is the x-axis. So this gives us our graph right there. Looking at a computer image, we get this picture right here. So notice that this point is an inflection point. It's concave down right there. It's concave up right there. This point right here is a maximum. It was increasing, then decreasing. You see the asymptotic behavior as it approaches the x-axis. You see the asymptotic behavior as it approaches the y-axis there.